Bismillah. Alhamdulillah. You know what? I tried to trade this question off with David a minute ago. He wouldn't trade. We were doing real good up till then. But he read it, and that's why he didn't want it. Okay, here we go. Why do Muslims kill people for their beliefs? Yo, baby. Let me read it to you from the Quran and let you be the judge. I'm looking in Surah Al-Ma'idah. This is a very important surah. Of course, all of them are important. Dealing with the subjects of what is halal, what is haram, what's permissible, what's forbidden. Dealing with the establishment or reestablishment of the original Sharia or the Islamic law, which came from the very beginning. It's the same God, it's the same law, the commandments of Almighty God. And he's just clarifying, and Allah says in chapter 5, verse 32. And this is right after the story of Cain and Abel. Cain and Abel is mentioned in here, Habil and Qabil, and what they did and how it came about. But now it says, because of what Allah has ordained for the children of Israel, that if anybody killed a person without cause, meaning in other words, not in retaliation or anything like that, or if they did it to spread mischief in the land, it would be as if he killed all of mankind. And if anybody saves a life, it's as if he saved the life of all mankind. And indeed, there came to them Allah's messengers with clear proofs, evidences, and signs. Even then, after that, many of them continued to transgress the limits in the land. The recompense for those, I'm in the next verse. The recompense for those who wage war against Allah and his messenger and do mischief in the land is only that they shall be killed or crucified, or their hands or their feet be cut off on opposite sides, or be exiled from the land. That is their disgrace in this world, and a great torment is theirs in the hereafter. But it very clearly is saying why. Because when people are killing other people, you have to stop them. There's a reference for this one that you didn't give me that one. I thank you for not getting any harder. I mean, you did. But there's one that has been sent to me after a speech, and I read it, and it said, why does your book say you have to kill all the Jews and Christians? That's what they said. You didn't give me that one, but I will connect it with what we're talking about here. Email and internet is where you find this over and over. Muslims have to kill all the Jews and Christians. This is a very twisted mind from somebody trying to twist the scripture of Allah's words. It doesn't say that anywhere in the Quran. Nowhere. In fact, it teaches us how to live side by side in a very beautiful way. But yet at the same time to defend ourselves and to defend Islam. What they misquote is the verse in Surah Al-Baqarah 191. It says, and kill them wherever you find them. And then in parentheses, they say the Jews and Christians. That's what they say. I happen to know a little bit of Arabic. I don't pronounce it very good. I get stuck sometimes. But I'll tell you what, I got a dictionary. It helps me. And it doesn't say that. You have to go to the verse before it. It also starts out with the word and. Both of them start with and, so that means what? You still don't have the whole thought. When anybody walks up to you or you walk in on a conversation and the guy says and, you missed something, yes or no? Okay, so let's go to the verse before that. Yasalunaka, they ask you, O Muhammad, about the new moons. Moons. Say, these are signs to mark fixed periods of time for mankind and for Hajj. Hajj, the pilgrimage. And it is not al-birr that you enter the houses from the back door, but al-birr is the one who has taqwa or fear of Allah. Enter your houses through proper doors and fear Allah that you will be successful and fight in the way of Allah those who fight you, but do not transgress the limits. What was that talking about? Because he used the word in Arabic, وَقَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ. I'll stop there. What does that mean? The word in Arabic is a combat. It means to engage in combat and fight even to the death. That's what it's talking about. What is the connection between that and Hajj? Do you know? Because it was when they were going out that this verse comes. And now they've given the permission. Because for 13 years, the Muslims were not allowed to retaliate, even though they were being abused, battered, insulted, and even killed. The women were, I don't want to say, but mutilated, and they did many things to them. And the first martyr in Islam was Sumaya, and she was killed in a horrible way. But they were not allowed to retaliate. You do not have to teach Arabs how to fight. Arabs are born with a rock in their hand. But what Allah was teaching them was how to be steadfast and persevere and only fight for the right things. Because you see, at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was an ongoing feud that started over a camel race. The camel race, and then somebody kills the camel out of jealousy, then somebody kills him, and then they kill that one, and it went on for 40 years of killing and killing and killing. That was the kind of thing that the Arabs in Jahiliyyah used to do. But when they came in Islam, the Prophet ﷺ forbid them, and Allah forbid them. They were not allowed to do any more than just defend themselves in an actual confrontation. He ﷺ was beaten in front of the Kaaba almost to death, along with his best friend and companion, Abu Bakr. That's fact. But the Muslims did not go and retaliate. They didn't go out and say, okay, we're going to sneak out tonight. We're going to get those guys. They didn't do that. They waited and waited and waited. And then comes this verse. وَقَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ. Those who are killing you. وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُتَّدِينَ. Meaning that you don't transgress the limits because Allah doesn't love those who transgress the limits. It's there still in Arabic as it was at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Nobody's playing with the verses. Nobody from our side, that is. Allah continues, and now we go to the next verse. And it's another form of this word, katilu or kital, waqtuluhum. Now this in Arabic does mean kill, not fight, kill. Waqtuluhum, and it says, and kill them wherever you find them, turn them out from where they turned you out. And nobody puts that in the emails or the websites, and I'm going to tell you why. Because then people would say, turn you out from where? Turn what happened? What's the story? They want to know. Because the Muslims were expelled from their own land, from their own homes, from their own families. They were ripped, raped, robbed, and kicked out of their own land and thrown out into the desert to die for over 2 years. True or false? And then they migrated to Medina. And it wasn't until this verse came that they had the right to go back and claim back their own property and their own possessions. Yes or no? And that was what they did in the very first fight when they did go out and they did fight at the wells of Badr, was to claim back, because that the caravan was carrying their property in it. They were going to go sell it. Yes or no? Okay. So that's what it says. And then Allah is clear again, though. He said, turn them out from where they turn you out. And the fitna is worse than the killing. Meaning what? And fitna is not just an average word. When people are aggressive, abusive, and killing other people, sneaking up behind them and killing them, blowing them up, tearing down their buildings, when they do it in America, they call them what? Terrorists. Thank you. And when Mr. Bush stands on the White House lawn and declares his war against terrorism, everybody said, yeah, all right. But when a law tells you in here the very same thing for the same reason, then they said, oh boy, that's a book of, you know, Because it continues, and Allah says, and don't fight them, don't kill them, don't engage in this combat at the Masjid al-Haram, the holy sanctuary, unless they first fight you there. But if they kill you, then you kill them. Such is the payback for disbelievers. But if they cease, then Allah is all forgiving, most merciful. Fight them until there is no more terrorism. And worshiping of others along with Allah and every kind of worship is available for people to worship God without partners. But if they cease, again Allah says, let there be no transgression except al-zalimun. And let me close this one off by mentioning something important. When the Muslims were ordered to go fight these people who had committed these acts of terrorism, there were strong verses here and in other places, or Tawbah and others, and hadiths from Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam making it clear, if they stop, you have to stop. If they back off, you have to back off. And you don't go into their land and take it over, kick them out, and do what they did to you. You just claim back what was yours. Everybody following my point? And when you take captives in Islam, you treat them with respect, honor, dignity, and you feed them the food that you eat. You give them the same shelter that you have, and you only have them there to do one thing, and that's to show them what Islam really is, so they can worship their Lord alone without partners. And if they accept, they're your brothers in Islam, and you totally forgive them. But if they don't, you still let them keep their clothes on.